Statistics, I think it's very indicative of the conversation we've been having around manufacturing. The manufacturing sector has stagnated at 10% of the GDP over the last 10 years, meaning that we're not growing as fast as we should. This is mainly because of the global competitiveness issue, because we trade in a global environment where you have to be the best and the most competitive in order to compete and take part in the global environment. So those are some of the issues that then affect the number of exports we have. How competitive are we to export our products? How do we facilitate manufacturing to ensure that when people manufacture, they're doing it at the least cost possible, so that they can trade in the world economy? So those are some of the issues that come into mind. In terms of also the goods imported, if you look, we are importing much more than we are exporting.
Of course, there's that imbalance.
There's that balance. Have we become a supermarket for other countries, where they just sell their goods instead of us really promoting our local industries to be able to produce and sell in the market?
Of course, you've raised a pertinent issue around, are we exporting less? Are we importing more? Where does this leave the Kenyan manufacturing sector? Because I know there are interventions that are being made. From where you sit, what are some of the quick wins as a country we've been able to achieve?
I think as a country, part of the quick wins we've been able to achieve is really the government's decision that we should buy Kenya and build Kenya. The president himself on May 1st last year made a declaration that government bodies should procure from local companies where the capacity exists locally. So in my view, those are some of the strides, because we have to be able to locally support our own production so that when we produce, we have a market to sell to first locally, and then we can go beyond our local market. Most of the big brands who exist in the market are there because they were supported by their local consumers. If you look at countries like Korea, the Samsungs of this world started as companies within their own country, were supported by their local consumption, and eventually grew to be big export companies. So as a country, we need to look at what do we need to do to create export champions. How can we facilitate manufacturers to manufacture competitively? How can we buy their goods and become their brand ambassadors by using their goods so that we can grow then our export market?
The other issue, of course, Phyllis, is, as you're saying, can we support our local industry? But when you walk through the shops, perhaps you want to buy a pair of jeans in some market in Kariakoo, and if you walk into, let's say, Mr. Price or any other retail store, the price variation would make someone say, hey, instead of buying this thing in Kariakoo, I'm getting more value at this other shop. How do we convince our population that, hey, it's time that we considered buying local stuff, and how does pricing play into it? Because at the end of the day, this person who made these jeans had some inputs, electricity, I mean, rent, and the list is endless, and they have to meet all the expenses before they can actually make a return on the investment.
I agree with you that pricing is an issue, and it's something that has to do with the cost and ease of doing business in our country. Because for us to be able to convince the local Kenyan consumer to come and buy the goods, they have to be at a price that is actually affordable to them. As the Kenya Association of Manufacturers, we've been speaking about the priorities that we want government to address. And next week we'll be launching the manufacturing priority agenda for this season. Key on what we'll be discussing is, first of all, we are keen about the regulatory environment and ensuring that our general policy framework supports the growth of manufacturing. If you look at issues like taxation at the county level, that is affecting the cost of the product. Once you manufacture and you're taxed heavily, it affects what the price will be. If you look at issues of duplicative regulatory requirements, where you have different regulatory bodies looking for the same issues, and you're paying double levies in some cases, that has an impact on the cost of the product. Another issue that is important to us is creating a level playing field, because there are situations where you're competing against counterfeit goods or substandard products, and of course that playing field then makes it harder for the local manufacturer who's genuinely manufacturing their products then to access the market, because he'll be competing against goods that have either been highly subsidized in other countries, where we are having goods coming in at below production prices in their home country. It's hard to compete against against goods like that. And then looking at the issues of export competitiveness, how quickly do we get our goods through the port? I saw the news item about trade logistics and how the BATs are going to improve the time it takes to move goods, because all this do play into the final cost, the trade logistics, the cost of energy.
Yeah.
So how do we manufacture competitively? That's also the third pillar in the priority agenda. The fourth is on export competitiveness. The fifth is on securing the future of industry. What you're talking about, the SMEs.
Yeah.
How do we bring SMEs into this playing field? I'm happy about what the CS of industry is doing by setting up the incubation centers for the Jua Kali sector.
Yeah.
But once those centers are set up, how do we then link them up to markets?
Yeah.
Does it mean we look for big companies who want subcontracting so that some of the products are made there and subcontracted? Can we look at then looking for opportunities within the trade agreements we have signed where these goods can be sold? So those are some of the priorities that government needs to address if we're going to be able to grow the sector.
The other issue, Phyllis, is Kenya hopes to be industrialized by 2030.
Yes.
Is it a pipe dream?
I think it's possible if we are committed to what we set out to do. I know as a fact the Ministry of Industrialization launched the Kenya Industrial Transformation Program last year. And this program is really seeking to grow the contribution of manufacturing to 15% of the GDP. It's looking at growing SMEs within the country. It's looking at creating 1 million jobs in manufacturing. And all these things, if we have a concerted effort as industry and as the government, I think are actually achievable. But it needs us to work together very closely to achieve the vision of having a fully industrialized economy by 2030. Yes.
And if you look at the other economies that Kenya is sort of trying to benchmark with, the likes of Egypt, the likes of Ethiopia, South Africa. I mean, if you look at the number of jobs being delivered per annum, in Kenya, we are yet, we actually barely scratching the surface.
Yes.
Is it that we don't get our policies right when it comes to the manufacturing industry? We've seen like three companies in the last like 2 years closing and exiting Kenya. One of them was Eveready. A number of jobs were lost. If you look at the other company, Kenya Flospa, they also shut down operations, of course, citing issues to do with commodity prices. And we don't know who is coming up next, I mean.
Yes, thank you for that. I think if you look at each of those issues, Eveready, for example, closed down because of counterfeits. They couldn't compete with the counterfeit market. So the black economy has to be something we purposely target as a country because it has led to the closure of some companies. If you look at Flospa, you're saying they've shut down because of the market dynamics. We always have to remember as a country that we are playing in an international market. We have the steel sector currently competing with very cheap imports from Asia, and they are unable to do that. But what policy instruments can we put in place as a government to ensure that at any given time, we are taking stock of what is happening in the world economy and ensuring that we protect our manufacturers so that they're able to create, continue creating jobs. So by the time the storm passes, we don't end up with our manufacturing sector not existing, but we create an environment that ensures we are cushioned in some cases against some of this volatility in the world market.
If you look at the broader picture, and Kenya does not operate in isolation, as you've actually rightly said. The president did announce that power prices are likely to go down. If you follow what's been happening with the electricity generator, it appears to be true that close to 30% of power costs have gone down. Manufacturers have been taking the heat. Consumers are expecting the cost of basic commodities to go down. We are not seeing this happening on the ground. Why?
Okay. The issue about energy, I must commend the government because they've done a lot in terms of increasing the capacity on the grid. We're at over 2,200 megawatts. When we started off with the current government, we're at about 1,600 megawatts. That is quite commendable. The fuel adjustment levy has also gone down, which we must recognize. But if you look at it in comparative terms, because we are still speaking of a world economy, Kenya is at about still 15 US cents per kilowatt hour. You're competing against Ethiopia, which is probably at 4 US cents, and other countries that are that much lower, including our neighbors like Uganda. So looking at the bigger picture, what does that mean in terms of the cost of a product? If you had my conversation before this, I didn't speak about the cost of energy because a lot of other things affect the cost of a product. The cost of labor, the cost of raw materials, the cost of the trade logistics that it gets to get your raw materials to yourself. So the bigger picture, energy does have an impact on the cost of the final product, but it's not the one size fits all, and it's not the only component.
Yeah.
And there are certain industries where it is a higher component, say for example the cement industry or the steel industry,
mm-hmm.
where it could contribute to a higher amount. And in some of those industries like cement, we have seen prices going down.
Mm-hmm.
But in some industries where you're manufacturing, say for example, bread or milk, the cost of energy might not be such a high contributor.
Okay.
So I think if we're going to fix the cost of products, we need to look at the entire system and the entire contribution to the cost of a product.
Mm-hmm.
And when we talk about energy also, we have to look at the quality of that energy, the reliability of that energy, because all these do add up to how effective it is to manufacture and how cost effective it is.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Good place to wrap up the conversation. Mm-hmm. Of course, I can't leave without asking you your closing thoughts on one of the biggest issues with the CAM is that you've been a lobby voice, mm-hmm. sort of, mm-hmm. in the private sector.
Yes.
Now that we are seeing some headwaves being made here and there, what else should we expect from CAM?
From CAM, as I mentioned, we are launching our manufacturing priority agenda next week on 7th March. This is really setting out a framework of what is required to make it competitive to manufacture locally. Another big focus area for us this year is the SME sector. We've set up an SME advisory center, SME development, where we will be working with SMEs on issues of market linkages.
Yeah.
We'll have mentorship programs. We'll have trainings on different areas that are important on product development, branding of products. We'll also work on market linkages. We are starting a project next week on COMESA, local sourcing,
mm-hmm.
where we're saying, can we source locally for our retail market, for our hotels within the COMESA region? So it's a program that CAM will be running for the next 6 months. We will take manufacturers who are mainly SMEs and small industries,
mm-hmm.
through trainings on standards. We will visit their sites and we'll link them up with the buyers locally and also eventually within the COMESA region.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so there's a lot of activity happening, and we are also working very closely with the county governments to look at the cost of doing business within the counties and the ease of doing business. There will be conversations around that in the near future.
Many thanks.
Thanks a lot.
Always a pleasure speaking to you.
Nice speaking to you too.
We've been speaking there to Phyllis Wakiaga, the Chief Executive Officer of Kenya Association of Manufacturers. She does sound optimistic that Kenya will indeed industrialize come 2030, and a lot of legwork is happening at the moment, and there is talk of setting up an SME unit and quite a number of other things. Well, we'll be keeping our eyes on that, and just to give you the latest on what's happening on the manufacturing front, we want to take a quick commercial break. When we come back, we'll be talking matters agribusiness. Don't go too far.